stand and worship with us?
Worship the King, all glorious above, gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise.
Sing, oh tell of His might.
Oh tell of His might, oh sing of His grace. Robe is the light, whose canopy space, His chariots of wrath and deep thunder clouds born, and dark is His path on the wings of the storm. O children of dust, feeble as frail, in Thee do we trust, nor find Thee to fail. How firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
Sing, oh worship the King.
Oh worship the King, all glorious above. Gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned splendor and girded with praise.
Amen. We come together to worship Him, to worship the King together. We sing praises to Him. We sing, can we get the music down? Don't know. There it goes. Okay. Okay, we come together. The Bible tells us we come not only to worship praises to Him, but to also sing to one another. We're commanded to sing one to another. And that's why it's good that you can hear the people around you. And whether you think it or not, it's good that people can hear you. So we come together to do that. We want to welcome you to Emmanuel this morning. If you're a guest with us, I want to invite you to fill out our guest card, which you can find by scanning one of the QR codes on the bulletin. I did not grab one to have up here, but you'll see two QR codes. One takes you to our newsletter, and the other takes you to sort of our guest form. So if you just scan that with your phone, you can get on there. It just takes a few seconds to fill out. In just a minute, we're going to walk around and welcome you. You can turn around and welcome those around you. But we are doing our Adopt a College Student program this year. I've got several college students signed up, and they're asking somebody to come and get to know them, to pray for them, to maybe make them dinner once or twice this semester. If you would be willing to do that, I need three more sponsors to step in to help cover our students. So when you eat break to shake hands and all that, you can go back there to the table in the sanctuary. There's a blue card. Fill out the side that says sponsor sign up and either give it to me. You could put it in the offering plate and it'll probably find its way to me. I need three more. So if you haven't signed up for that, please do. I would love for you to be able to serve our college students that way. With that, turn around, find somebody you haven't seen this week. Tell them you're glad to see him this morning. Thank you.
close to your side. So heaven is real, and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above, singing as one.
Sing hallelujah. Say, I want to be near.
I want to be near, near to your heart, loving the world and hating the dark. I want to see dry bones living again, singing as one.
Y'all can have a seat. This is the God that we praise. The great I am, self-sufficient, all-sufficient. As we continue to sing and worship this song we've been doing for a couple months now, it asks this question. Do you feel the world is broken? And we do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? And we say we do. But then it asks, but do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? And this song comes from Revelation 7, and I just wanted to read for us Revelation 7, 15 through 17, that gives us this promise. Will the dark keep the light from getting through? Absolutely not. And John has seen a great multitude worshiping before God, and he tells us this: for this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. The one seated on the throne will shelter them. They will no longer hunger. They will no longer thirst. The sun will no longer strike them, nor will any scorching heat. For the Lamb who is at the center of the throne will shepherd them. He will guide them to springs of the waters of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. That's the promise. So when we sing and you all affirm, you say, we do, we know this, that's the promise. Let's sing together.
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of it?
He
the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And is Jesus our Messiah? Oh, forever those he loves.
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he's David's root and the Lamb who died to slave.
From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom of priests to God, to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this?
You stand and affirm this with your whole heart.
He is. He is. He is. He is. He is worthy.
He is worthy.
same chapter, before it tells us that Jesus is worthy to take that scroll, he's worthy to know the beginning from the end, it tells us the reason he's worthy is because he is the Lamb who was slain. It's because he was slain for our sake. And John turns around expecting to see a lion, and it says that he sees a lamb standing as though slain. And so that is why he's worthy. And we're going to continue to sing that simple truth that Jesus Christ came. He lived a perfect life on your behalf, for your sake, and he died, though he was not a sinner, he was innocent, and he rose again to give us life. We celebrate these truths. Let's sing them together.
Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, be the perfect Son of Man in his living.
Jesus, we give you praise and glory and honor because you are the Lamb that was slain. You took a sin and a punishment and a death that you did not deserve, and from it you give us life. God, I pray that we would receive that life and grace this morning. As your children, we need that grace every day, and there are many in this, there are some in this room perhaps that don't know the love and grace you have. And I pray that your word and your spirit would cut to our hearts today. That we would trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church family. I hope that you enjoyed the gospel that you just sang about. I hope that you relished the truths that you were singing. Those are things that we need to marinate in, and I'm grateful for Craig helping us marinate in those things. So this morning, maybe when you came in, you noticed that there's some tubs with some bags out in the foyer, and the reason we haven't told you about them yet is because the bags are filled with snacks. There's Pringles and crackers, and I was afraid that if we told you ahead of time, you'd bring them in and just start eating them, but they're not for you. These are called blessing bags, and the goal of it is for you to take one and stick it in your car, and sometime when you come across somebody in need, there's a prayer on there, there's a verse of scripture, and then just some snacks, and just a way to bless somebody that might be in need. So that's what these are for. So on your way out, there's the blue tubs. Grab one, stick it in your car, and as you do, pray and ask God that he'll put somebody in your path that you can bless with that bag. Last night, our family watched a movie. It's a heist movie. You like those kind of movies where there's a heist and where, you know, a lot of times there's a swap. So the bad guys think that they're getting away with something, and they get back to their place, and they have a briefcase, and they think there's going to be $1 million in there, and they open it up, and it's filled with newspaper clippings or something like that. You like those kind of movies? I love those kind of movies. I want you to know that's what's happening this morning. That's about to happen to you. So you came to church. You're about to open up the briefcase. You think there's going to be $1 million in there, and it's not going to be there. I swapped the cases on you. So this morning, instead of your dose of Daniel that you thought you were going to get, we are actually going to talk about Baptist history and distinctives. Baptist history and distinctives, which of course we're going through on Sunday nights. We're going through why am I a Baptist? And the reason I swapped them today is because as I was studying the one that we're going to look at this Sunday night, it is the foundational thing, the mark of being a Baptist. And I figure all of you need to know about it, and then you need to know what it means for us as a church and what it means for you as individuals. So if you want to hear about Daniel chapter 8 and the vision in Daniel chapter 8, you'll have to come back tonight. Come back tonight at 6 right here, and I'll share with you about Daniel chapter 8. So why are you here? Why are you in a Baptist church this morning? There are generally three reasons that you might be here. And if you have a bulletin, which I dropped here, if you have a bulletin, you should grab it because there's a whole lot of fill in the blanks on the front and you'll want to follow along, and I'm going to ask you to do some reading from this too. So make sure you grab this. So the very first thing, three reasons why people are Baptists: from conditioning, from convenience, or from conviction. Conditioning, convenience, conviction. Conditioning. Maybe you were raised in a Baptist church. Maybe you got saved through a Baptist ministry. Maybe you married a Baptist. And so for reasons of life circumstances, that's why you're here. Maybe your parents made you come. All right, you're a Baptist because of conditioning. Or number two, maybe you're a Baptist of convenience. You're a Baptist because you presently attend a Baptist church. You moved to town and you like the preaching and the music and the programs here. Maybe you felt welcomed here, and so just out of convenience, you decide this is where I'm going to stay. But where we all want to get to is the last one, that we are Baptists out of conviction, because what we see in a Baptist church matches what we see in God's Word, so that we're here because of what we believe. There's nothing wrong with getting in the door with the first two approaches, but you need to grow past that. You need to, the church that you choose to go to, it needs to be because you are convicted that they teach the Bible and that that's where God wants you. Now, in our study, we're identifying these theological convictions that have historically defined Baptists. And last Sunday night, we looked at the Baptist family tree. We started with the early church, the church in the New Testament, and that went down into the Roman Catholic Church throughout the Middle Ages until the Reformation happened. And then the Reformation happened, and we went over with the Church of England is sort of where our line goes, the Church of England, and then the Puritans in the Church of England, and then the Separatists from the Puritans. And then we broke off of the Separatists. And the reason Baptists broke away from all these groups is because of our convictions over what we read in God's Word. As a Baptist church, this is a fill in the blank for you. As a Baptist church, our goal is to conform every aspect of our congregational life to the will of God as revealed in the Bible. That's our goal. Everything we do, we want it to come from here. That's what it means to be a Baptist. The latest trends in religion don't determine what we do. Tradition in the church doesn't determine what we do. The Bible determines what we do. Now, I've been here long enough to know that y'all aren't a church that likes to say amen on Sunday mornings during sermons. I figured that out, and I've learned to deal with it, and that's okay. But sometimes I say something that's so important that you need to say amen. Okay, I'm going to give you another shot. Let me repeat that again, and you'll know when, okay? The latest religious trends don't determine what we do. Tradition doesn't determine what we do. The Bible determines what we do. There you go. Was that so hard? That was nice. All right, so this morning we're going to talk about something in the Bible that Baptists saw that no one else had seen for 1,000 years. No one in the church for 1,000 years saw this truth from the Bible. It's the truth of regenerate church membership, also known as the believer's church. The greatest contribution we as Baptists have made to church history was rediscovering regenerate church membership in the scriptures. And now, I want you to know the things I'm about to share with you. I am indebted to a couple of textbooks. I am not this smart. The things that you hear me say, I'm not this smart. There's a book called The Baptist Story by Shute, Finn, and Haken. And then there's another book called Biblical Foundations for Baptist Churches by John Hammett. Much of what I share today comes from those guys, not from me. So let's start by defining regenerate church membership. Here's another fill in the blank, and this one's important because I'm going to ask you to read it after we fill in the blank. Baptists believe that a local church's membership should only be made up of individuals who provide credible evidence that they have repented of their sins and trusted in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. All right, will you read that with me? Right there on your page, it starts with the words Baptists believe. Here we go. Baptists believe that a local church's membership should only be made up of individuals who provide credible evidence that they have repented of their sins and trusted in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That's a good one to say amen. That's right, Billy. Now, if you read that and you think, well, that's just common sense. Anybody knows that. That's because you're Baptistic in your theology. Not everybody else believes that or thinks that. Because while the early church, the New Testament church, practiced what we just read, that was lost, and for 1,000 years, hardly anybody practiced this. It was gone. And we'll talk about how that happened in a moment. As Baptists, we believe that church membership is only for those who believe the gospel of Jesus and acknowledge him as Lord. For those of you who have joined EBC since I got here, you'll remember that when we had a membership meeting, the very first question I asked you was, what is the gospel? I wanted to hear from your lips, what is the gospel? Because you have to know it and to accept it to be saved, to be regenerated, to be a Christian. Believing and receiving the gospel is the only way to get into God's family, and it should be the only way to get into God's church. And the consistent pattern in the New Testament is that conversion, being regenerated, happens prior to becoming a part of a church. In other words, you can't be a church member if you aren't converted. Let me show you a couple of places. So if you'll open your Bible to Acts chapter 2. The book of Acts chapter 2. I'm going to show you a few verses in Acts. So Acts chapter 2, verse 41. Let me read it, and then I'm going to ask you a question about it. Acts 2, 41. So those who accepted his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 people were added to them. So who was baptized and added to the church? Those who accepted Peter's message. And you can look back a few verses to verse 38 to see Peter's message. repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins. So only the people who accepted that message were received in the church. Look down, still in Acts 2, look down at verse 47. The second half of verse 47 says, every day the Lord added to their number. Who was added to the number of the church? Those who were being saved. Turn over a page. Acts chapter 4, verse 4 says, but many of those who heard the message believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. So how did these additional people get added to the church? They believed. They heard the message about Jesus, and they believed. This pattern goes on into the New Testament, into the letters of Paul. Let me show you one place. You can look at all his letters and see this, but just go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 by way of example. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2. Paul says, to the church of God at Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called as saints, with all those in every place who call on the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. The church is made up of those who are sanctified, those who have called on the name of Jesus and believe in him. So do you see this pattern here? From the New Testament, the church is only made up of those who believe and receive the message of Jesus. You can't be a part of the church if you don't believe and receive the message of Jesus. But that wasn't the case for 1,000 years of church history. During this 1,000-year gap, which is somewhere around the 400 AD to 1500 AD, during that time, the church believed that every person in one of the Christian nations was a member of the church. They believed that every person in their nation was a member of the church. Now, this is hard for us to wrap our minds around, but if you were to go into the year 1550, take a time machine back, and you go to Italy in 1550, every single member of the nation of Italy was a member of the Roman Catholic Church. If you were to go up to Germany that same year, every single member of the country of Germany was a Lutheran. If you go up to England, every single individual in the state of the nation of England was a member of the Church of England. 100% of the people were church members. And that leads us to a couple of questions. How did that happen? Why were Christians okay with that? And how did they get so far removed from the practice of regenerate church membership that we see in the New Testament? How did we lose it? Well, the short answer is that there were two major changes that happened. First, a change inside the church, and then second, a change outside the church. The change inside the church was the adoption of the practice of infant baptism. Infant baptism is also known as paedobaptism. And that practice was developed by Christians who they looked at God's word, and they looked back into Old Testament history, and they reasoned, okay, so in the Old Testament, new male babies were circumcised, and then they were a part of God's covenant people. And so those Christians reasoned, well, if in the Old Testament babies were a part of God's covenant people, in the New Testament it must be the same thing. And so they started baptizing infants into the church. The advocates for this, they claimed that as children of believing parents, the children should have a special connection to the church, and they should be considered members of the church even prior to their faith. Now, I want to say this respectfully, because there are denominations today that I consider brothers and sisters in Christ who practice paedobaptism. I'm trying to be respectful here, but I think they're all wrong. There is no evidence in the New Testament of baptizing infants. You can't find it anywhere. And the practice of infant baptism didn't appear until 150 years after Paul and Peter and most of the other apostles had died. So 150 years later, somebody started this practice. And it wasn't until the 4th century when the practice kind of took off and sort of became the norm. And it happened at the same time that Christianity became the official religion of the Roman Empire. That is when paedobaptism became the norm. Now, for us as Baptists, the argument of hearing that infants should be baptized sounds wrong to our ears. Because while we do believe that our children, we believe they have an advantage over others, it's strictly because of their close proximity to the gospel, their close proximity to people that are walking with Jesus. We do not believe that our children can be saved by our faith. That's important that you know that. We do not believe that your children can be saved because they watch your faith or their grandparents' faith. Each of our children must choose to submit themselves to Jesus, believe and receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. So that was the change that happened inside the church, was this practice of infant baptism. But there was, I think, perhaps even a bigger change outside the church, which led us away from regenerate church membership. It was the church found political power. The church found political power. So you've probably heard of the Roman Emperor Constantine. He was converted to Christianity in 312 AD, and he made it legal. For a long time, it had been illegal to be a Christian in the Roman Empire. When Constantine made that change, things changed for the church. They no longer had to hide. They, in fact, they could even be a respected member of society. But it went further. You get to the end of the 300s, like 380 AD, and Christianity was made the official religion of the Roman Empire. It was made the official one. And what's worse, I don't know if you're familiar with this, it might sound strange to you, when they made it the official religion in 380 AD, then they said, and we're going to persecute anyone that's not a Christian. The state said, persecution's fair game for anybody that's not a Christian, because this is our official religion now. And the tables turned. Now there were political advantages to being a Christian. Before persecution tended to keep church membership numbers accurate with genuine believers. Because as you can imagine, nobody was going to sign up to go be a member of a church and then face the lions in the arena. Persecution tended to keep who came to church and genuine believers the same. But after Constantine, the church became the recipient of state funds. The Roman government started building church buildings with state money. If any of you have ever had a chance to go to Europe and see some of these incredible cathedrals, and you think, how in the world could Christians afford this? Well, they couldn't. The state built all those cathedrals. The state paid for it. And as you well know, state money always comes with strings attached, doesn't it? Always comes with some expectations. Let me give you an example of what these type of conversions started looking like in the Roman Empire, or the empire from Rome and on, because of this church-state partnership. So in 496, Clovis, who was the first king of the Franks, decided to become a Christian for political reasons. And so he got baptized, and he made all 3,000 members of his army also be baptized. Do you think those were regenerate church members? No, of course not. But now there were benefits to being a baptized Christian. And this type of conversion was common as Christianity spread across Europe. It was not unusual for whole villages and whole cities, when they were conquered by a Christian army, the whole village would be baptized. Do you think those were regenerate people? Legitimate conversions? No, they weren't. As one historian puts it, the Roman Catholic Church made it so easy to become a Christian that actual conversion seldom happened. It was so easy, you just get baptized and you're a Christian. Because baptism began, the definition of baptism changed. Baptism was seen as the thing that provided forgiveness of your sins. It didn't matter, you didn't even have to believe. But if you were baptized by a priest, you're good now. You're in. And the idea of regenerate church membership was effectively lost for 1,000 years. And it's not surprising that it coincides with the era of greatest biblical illiteracy in history. The greatest biblical illiteracy happened, and the reason it happened was because during these centuries, the Bible was not taught or read in the common language. It was only taught in Latin. It was only read in Latin, the language of Rome. And yet it was being preached all over Europe in Latin, and nobody understood what they were listening to. And nobody could have a copy of Scripture except for church leadership. It shouldn't surprise us that all kinds of divergent practices started happening when God's people had no access to His Word. And this should be a warning to us. If we ever let human reasoning, if we ever let the traditions of church, if we ever let those things become front and center instead of this, the same thing can happen to us. The same fate can happen to us. This is our guide for faith and practice. I like this new amen thing. It just pops up occasionally. It's nice. Now, in the 1300s, so some things started changing because there was a man named John Wycliffe. John Wycliffe started translating the Bible into English. He's one of the first that thought, maybe we should have this in the language of the common people. And other men all over Europe took up his calling, and a lot of them were burned at the stake as heretics, that they were translating the Bible into something other than Latin. But these vernacular translations began to pop up all over Europe, but there weren't very many of them until 1440. In 1440, there's a man named Johannes Gutenberg. You know what he invented? He invented the printing press. And now all of a sudden, the availability of Bibles exploded all across Europe, and people could have God's word in their own language. They could read it themselves. And as they read it, you know what they saw? They said, what we're doing at church doesn't match this. This is where the Reformation started. Now, you have to understand, and sometimes, you know, we might look back at the reformers like Luther and Calvin and Zwingli, and we say, why didn't they pick up regenerate church membership? Why didn't they pick up these other practices that the Bible teaches? But after 1,000 years of scriptural ignorance, there was a lot to be done. And they couldn't get all of it, but they started laying the groundwork that others came along behind them. And it was Baptists. Baptists were the first people in 1,000 years to read God's word and rediscover this idea of regenerate church membership. To look at God's word and say, maybe the church should only be made up of individuals who actually are saved. That was Baptists. We were the first ones. And every major Baptist confession of faith that's been printed since 1611 affirms this principle of regenerate church membership. If you go online sometime today, look up the Baptist Faith and Message 2000, Article 6 is about regenerate church membership. So what do we do now? So in the last 400 years that we found it, we've reclaimed it. How do churches keep this practice? Historically, Baptists have used two practices to help. And we're back to the fill in the blanks here. Two practices that Baptists have used. One is church covenants, and two is church discipline. Church covenants and church discipline. Now, church covenants are not commanded by Scripture. Church discipline is commanded by Scripture. So a church covenant, this is the next fill in the blank, a church covenant is a series of commitments based on the Bible, which church members voluntarily make. Nobody forces them to. They say, yes, I'm going to do that. And until the 20th century, it was understood. Anybody that came to a Baptist church, they knew we're signing up for the church covenant. A lot of times, some of you growing up, if you grew up in a Baptist church, you might have even had a church covenant on the wall, big and framed. Now, they have fallen out of practice. We, Emmanuel, we have a church covenant. How many of you have ever seen or read our church covenant? I'm just curious if you have. So maybe like 10, 15% of us. Okay, so it's obviously not something we use formally, not something that's been used regularly over the years. But I want you to know that even though we don't make use of a formal covenant, when we have new members come, I do ask them for some commitments. So you see the gold papers around? If you got a gold paper near, grab it. You can look on with somebody else. So those, I don't even have one, but I think that, would you hand me that one, Richard, right here? Thank you. So right there where it says EBC Congregational Commitments, These are the things I ask people when they want to join our church. And all of these things are essentially taken from Scripture. Do you commit to let the Bible dictate what you believe and how you behave? Do you commit to privately worshiping Jesus? Do you commit to publicly worshiping Jesus? Do you commit to grow with other believers? And on. You can read that there. I just thought you might be interested to know, when people come to join the church and you see me introduce them down here, we've already had a conversation and we've walked through. I ask them to tell me about, well, first I ask them what the gospel is. Then I ask them to tell me their testimony. And then we walk through this as far as what is walking as Christians together look like. There it is. Now, the other practice that Baptists have used for centuries to maintain regenerate church membership is church discipline. Church discipline. Nobody likes to talk about discipline, do they? While church covenants aren't something in Scripture, church discipline absolutely is all over the pages of the New Testament. Here's a fill in the blank for you. Church discipline is the practice of holding believers accountable for their doctrine and behavior. Holding believers accountable for their doctrine and behavior. See, the New Testament anticipated the possibility that false members would creep into the church, and it provides church discipline as the solution for that. So that when a member's doctrine or their behavior undermines the gospel, and that's important, we're not just talking about any errant behavior, but we're talking about behavior or doctrine that undermines the gospel and challenges something important, central to what we believe. Church discipline calls true believers to repent, and it exposes false believers. That's what it does. True believers, it should call them to repentance, exposes false believers. Now, a very important point here. Church discipline is not ever meant to be punitive. It's not a punishment. Church discipline is meant to be redemptive and restorative. The next fill in the blank for you, or maybe it's not, maybe I just put it there. The church doesn't discipline for sins. Church discipline isn't for sins. It's for unrepentance over sins. Because if we were disciplining people for sin, you know what? None of us would be here this morning. I couldn't even be standing up here if we disciplined and we excommunicated people when they sin. None of us would be here. But repentance, unrepentance, is what we discipline for. If somebody says, I know what Jesus says, I know what he's told me to do, and I'm not interested, I don't want to do it, then as a church, that's when church discipline sets in. Now, this isn't a sermon about church discipline, but I just thought you would know, should know, that's what it's for. It's to protect regenerate church membership. Now, the practice of formal church discipline it's declined sharply in Baptist churches over the past 100 years for a variety of reasons. We live in a culture that emphasizes individualism, right? Doesn't everyone in our culture says, you can't tell me what to do? That's what they all say, right? That church discipline is against that because church discipline is telling you what to do. Another reason is that there are concerns, and I think there are legitimate concerns, that people over the years have abused and misused church discipline. They've abused it, they've misused it, they've harmed people with the ways that they've handled church discipline. That's a very real concern. There's also, 150 years ago, there became this, in Baptist history, I don't know where it came from, but there became this drive to increase numbers, increase baptism numbers. And Southern Baptists went hard after that for 100 years, a lot of times to the exclusion of holiness and discipleship in people's lives. It was all about how many more people we can get it in here, rather than the people that we have here, are they growing? And then I think, especially in the last 3 decades, as larger churches have popped up, you can go to a large church and you can be anonymous, and nobody ever knows who you are or anything about you and whether you're walking with Jesus or not. That has also undermined regenerate church membership. Now, you need to know that from the Bible's viewpoint, when you join a church family, your private life becomes public property. You might not have been aware of that. I'm not telling you this. This isn't Clint talking. This is Scripture talking. When you join God's people, it says we become members of one another. No longer do we actually have just me that I'm worried about. I'm worried about all of y'all, and y'all are all worried about all of y'all and me, and it's all together. If you don't believe me, read 1 Corinthians chapter 12 today. And so that means how you live, when you walk out these doors, how you live the rest of the week, that affects the rest of us in this room. How you live affects the testimony about Jesus in our community. But while many Baptist churches have abandoned the biblical practice of redemptive church discipline, I'm grateful that our convention, so the Southern Baptist Convention that we're a part of, is rediscovering its importance. That's the other thing on the yellow page, or the gold page in front of you. Pick it up and look at it. At the 2008, so 13 years ago, the SBC annual meeting, we as a people adopted this resolution titled On Regenerate Church Membership and Church Member Restoration. You should read that sometime. This isn't what you're hearing today. Is not just coming from Clint. Like, this is our convention overall saying there's a problem and we need to do something about it. Now let me share the way this has played out. There are some numbers on that page, but those numbers are from like 2006 when the survey was done. Today, Southern Baptist Convention claims to have 15 million members in the U.S. 15 million members, which would make us the largest Protestant denomination in the country. You might have heard that thrown around. But on any given Sunday, even Easter Sunday, two-thirds of those people are nowhere to be found. So we claim to have 15 million members, but we can only find 5 million. Do we really have 15 million members then? No, what we have is a problem. And it's not just the national level. Church family, we have a problem. Our current membership shows that we have 677 members. You can look around if you want to count this morning. There are not that many people here. Best guess, I'd say 160 probably is what is in here right now. And that's pretty normal, 160, 170 on a Sunday. Where are the other 500 members of this church? Where are they? Most of them are in town today. Most of them are physically well, but they chose not to gather with us. And they've made that choice for a long time. Maybe it's, in many cases, for years they've made that choice. Why do we allow them to say they belong to Emmanuel Baptist Church? That makes no sense. And it's actually going backwards in history. That's the Roman Catholic way of membership. You can be a Catholic and never go to Mass. You can be a Catholic and live however you want to. That's what Baptists rediscovered was we look at Scripture and say, we're supposed to know who is actually the church. Now, why did I take a sermon time on a Sunday morning to talk about this? Well, it's because there are dire consequences if we ignore this truth from Scripture. Let me give you three reasons why this is important, and these are fill in the blanks. Without regenerative church membership, we give people a false sense of spiritual security. We give people a false sense of spiritual security. See, when we accept a person into our church family, when we baptize them, we are putting our stamp of approval on them. We are saying to them, we see evidence in you that you are a follower of Jesus. But how do we know that? How do we know that if we're not observing their life? If we're not talking about their beliefs? Do you want somebody to stand before Jesus one day, the last day, and say to Jesus, I was a member of Emmanuel, I gave my money to Emmanuel, I taught Sunday school at Emmanuel, and for Jesus to say, depart from me, I never knew you? That's going to happen to some people. Jesus talks about it in the book of Matthew. It's going to happen to people who are not regenerate. Because you can come in here and do all the normal stuff that many of us are doing and not actually know Jesus. So without regenerate church membership, we give people a false sense of security. The second thing that can happen, without regenerate church membership, we undermine Jesus before the watching world. We undermine Jesus. So I just told you, we have 500 some odd members out and about in our community right now, living who knows how, claiming to be members of our church. What do you think that does for the testimony of Jesus? Does it raise the Jesus in other people's eyes in our community? People say, oh yeah, I'm a member of Emmanuel, but I don't go. This is a very long quote, but I think it'll keep you interested, and it's super important. It's from a seminary professor at one of our Southern Baptist seminaries. Reports find almost no difference in the rate of divorce among Baptists and the culture as a whole. Many Baptists are enmeshed in alcoholism, addiction to pornography, spousal and child abuse, adultery, and virtually every other evil the world offers. A person can live a life with no visible difference from the surrounding world and be a member in good standing at most Baptist churches. That's despicable, and it's absolutely true. It's absolutely true. It should not be. We undermine Jesus to the watching world when we don't hold one another accountable to believe and practice the Bible. The third thing, without regenerate church membership, church governance is a disaster. Governing the church. Another Baptist distinctive that we'll get to in a couple of Sunday nights is we're going to talk about our value of autonomy, congregational autonomy. In other words, we believe that because God's Spirit dwells in each one of us, we don't need a pope in Rome, we don't need a bishop in Oklahoma City to tell us what to do as a church. We believe God can lead us personally and corporately the way that he wants us to go. But if our congregation includes people who aren't regenerate, people who are not walking in the Spirit, it will lead to strife. It will lead to quarreling. It will lead to disaster. You can't have unregenerate people voting on how to follow God. They don't know. They don't know how to follow God. Not to mention what happens if you actually put unregenerate people into leadership positions at churches. You talk about destroy a church, and it happens. Some of you might have experienced that. So what do we do with all this information that I've given you? Well, I think there's two things. One of them is a corporate response, and I don't know that we're not going to do anything about it this morning, but at some point we need to do something. There's a corporate response and there's a personal. The corporate response, we as a church, we need to evaluate our practices. We need to determine if we're being faithful to the Bible in the ways we accept new members, the ways we hold existing members accountable, and we have room for improvement. As I mentioned, we're missing 500 people. We need to address that. We need to make a plan so that doesn't happen anymore. But the more pressing issue is for you personally. What does this mean for you today? You must answer the question, am I a regenerate church member? Am I a regenerate church member? I can't answer that question for you. Your parents can't. Only you can answer that question. And on the bulletin, I have four marks, and I want you to look at them. You don't have to fill in the blank. You just look and listen. There are four marks to look for in your life. You need everybody in this room that would say, yeah, I'm a Christian, you need to look at all four of these, and this will tell you whether you're a Christian or not. Number one, do you actually believe what Jesus says? Do you change your actions according to what his word says? See, in John 3:36, it says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. And that belief is certainly you're placing your eternal destiny with Jesus. But it also means that you're placing all of your trust so that whatever he says about life, you're going to believe him over anything else, and you're going to do it. That's the first mark of being regenerate. Do you listen and believe and trust Jesus about everything he says? Second thing, when you sin, and you do, and I do, when you sin, do you see that it hurts your Father in heaven, and do you repent? In the book of Revelation, chapter 2, Jesus is talking to a local church, and Jesus says to them, I have this against you. You have abandoned your first love. You have abandoned God. Repent and do the works you did at first. Repentance is the normal practice for a Christian. And it's a mark that God lives in you. When you sin, if he calls you back to him and he calls you to turn from sin, that's a mark that he's in you. The third thing, Are your desires changing so that you increasingly love the things God loves and hate the things God hates? 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says that in Christ you're a new creation. Old things, they're passing away. New things have come. Romans 12:2 says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind so you know what God's will is and what's good. Galatians 5:16 says, walk in the Spirit and you won't carry out your sinful desires. One of the marks that you belong to God is that your desires are slowly changing. It's not a light switch moment. You don't get saved and all of a sudden you don't want anything bad anymore, but they should slowly be morphing and changing over time. And then fourth, are you growing in affection for your church family? Do you want to hang out with people that are different from you? Do you want to serve them? Do you want to help them grow? 1 John 3:14 says, we know we pass from death to life because we love our brothers and sisters. That's one of the marks of regeneration. You know it if you love other people in this room. Even if you don't like them, but you love them and you want to help them and you want to serve them and see them grow. Now, look at those four marks. Do you see all four of those in your life? Those are the marks of a regenerate heart. And if you see them in your life, praise God and don't take any credit because it's a miracle. You don't have anything to do with that. These are things the Holy Spirit does. And if you see it, that's proof the Holy Spirit's at work in you and changing you. And praise God for that. Now, some of you might look at them and you say, you know what, I have seen these marks over the course of my life, but they're not really as strong anymore. They're kind of, they've sort of faded. You need to do something about that. You need to do what Jesus encouraged the church in Revelation 2 to do. You've abandoned your first love. You need to repent and come back to him. If that's you this morning, you're here and you say, yes, I know I'm a believer, but some of these things have faded over time, and I want God to reawaken that, to relight the fire in me for him. Here in just a minute, I'm going to invite some of our prayer partners to come up here, and while we sing, they're going to be standing right up here. They're here for to pray with you. If there's something that you say, I want God to change me so that I am more faithful to him, come up and share that with our prayer partners, and they'll pray for you right now as when we sing. But the other thing I need to address is if you're here this morning and you look at those four things and you say, I don't see them, that's not me, these things aren't in my life, I don't trust Jesus, I don't believe him, I'd rather trust myself, or I don't repent of sin, I'd like to excuse my sin, defend myself, or you say, I don't really like being with Christians, or I haven't seen any spiritual changes in my life, then you are not saved. You are not saved. If these four things aren't true about you, you are not saved. And you have no hope that when you die, you will be with Jesus. No hope at all. In fact, your destiny right now would be hell, an eternal separation from God and everything that's good. Now, you might think, I walked the aisle. I came down and I told everybody I wanted to follow Jesus. I said a prayer to follow Jesus. Walking aisles and saying prayers to follow Jesus does not save you. Jesus saves you, and then he starts changing you on the inside. So you can do the outward motions, and if Jesus doesn't change something on the inside of you, you are not saved. Do you see these proofs? And my plea to you this morning, if you look at them, you say, I don't see it. Come talk to me, and don't put it off. While we're singing, I'm going to be standing right here. You can come talk to me now. Right after church, you can come find me. Don't put it off if you don't see the marks of regeneration in your life. Would you join me for prayer? Jesus, when we look to regeneration that may or may not have happened within us, for those of us who it has happened to, we give all praise and glory to you because it has nothing to do with us. It is your work, your spirit, and us agreeing with what you're doing. Father, if there is anyone here this morning that is not regenerate, maybe they've been fooling themselves for years and they thought they have been, I pray that you would expose that. Expose it so that they might come to repentance and they might find Jesus as their only hope and Savior. And I pray for all of us. God, every single one of us, there is sin in our lives. And all of us, there are ways that we have abandoned you, our first love. And we need to come back. So I pray that now as we sing that you would do a work of repentance among your people. And all these things I'm asking, I can't do anything here. This is all in your court, Jesus. Holy Spirit, your work of conviction. I pray that you would have your way among your people. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand, please, and let's sing together. Richard and Kelly, would you mind coming up here?
Come, ye sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore. Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity and power. To come ye thirsty, come and welcome God's free bounty glorified. To be
time. Y'all can have a seat, and I'd like to invite our ushers to come forward and take up our offering at this time.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, for allowing us to be here and to worship you, Lord, and hear the word that has been brought to us today. Lord, I pray that you would just be with each one here, Lord, that may not know you, that, Lord, they'd be convicted through words that Clint shared. Lord, I pray that the believers would just be encouraged, Lord, to look at our lives and see how we can follow you as you would have us to. Lord, I thank you for this time that we have to give back and to support this church. Lord, I just pray that the gifts that are given will be used for your glory. In your name we pray. Amen.
As we take the offering, those that have walk to Jesus and know Jesus, I think we can all join in and sing gladly as the plate passes you. If you want to stand up and sing with us, please do. Sing, 'tis so sweet.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise. Just to know the saved the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. How I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for grace to trust him.
Seat. That came out wrong. You guys can have a seat, and it is good to trust him. I want to just give you one announcement quick before Roger comes up with the rest of them. We've got a worship fellowship coming up next Saturday, and I'm excited about this, and you might be wondering if you can come to this, and the answer to that is maybe. If you serve on the worship team, or if you serve upstairs in the sound booth in any capacity, you can come, and it's going to be a good time to have fun together, to relax, to eat, to enjoy. We'll have childcare in the nursery, so please do come if you're serving. The other people that can come is if you would like to serve. If you look at us up here and you're thinking, I can sing. If you're thinking, I can play guitar, I can play bass guitar, I can play drums, I wonder if I could serve up there. Absolutely, you could, and I would invite you to come next Saturday in the gym. That's Saturday, what is that, the 25th, is that right? This coming up at 6 o'clock, we'll have dinner, we'll have fun. Please come. If you have a talent and you're trying to hide it from me, I really want to know about it. So please come if you're interested in serving. I would love to see you there and for you to be able to serve our church body with your time and your talents. So,
see, I'm one that would be sitting here thinking about the most unique talent I could come up with, that they're going to show up, and then you have to figure out how they can use that on Sunday morning worship.
Come on.
Okay? I'm looking at you, Nick. Just going to say. All right, so we have a few announcements, some things going on. Okay, first of all, Sunday nights is back, okay? 6 o'clock here on Sunday nights. We have something going on in here every week. Obviously, the pastor went and switched our briefcases today, so it'll be back kind of to normal next week, but come tonight at 6 o'clock. Also, for kids, grades 1 through 5, we are upstairs in the student wing with The Grove, okay? So if you have any friends of kids, neighbors that don't go to church, they're not involved, this is the thing that you get them to come to. Come. We've got a lot of our students and our college students coming to make this a fun time, an energetic time, a time when, you know, you as a parent would be like, wow, that's a little much. Absolutely, and we want it to be much. And so come, it'll be upstairs at 6 o'clock for grades 1st through 6th. On October 10th, here in a few weeks, we are not going to have normal service. We're going to switch your briefcase again, okay, right here. We're going to have our lake service, and I know usually we have that on Sunday nights, but however, we're going to change it that. We're going to do a Sunday morning lake service brunch, okay? So the brunch is at 10 a.m. at Crowder Lake, and then we're going to have the service at 11 o'clock that morning, okay? So make sure you make plans. There won't be grow groups that morning. We're just going to be out there. Obviously, we'll need to help moving some chairs and helping set up. So if you're on one of those teams, which is, this is my segue as we go into talking about teams and specifically committees, if you're on one of the standing committees of our church, we're meeting tonight at 5 o'clock. So the blessed team, the building and grounds team, the finance team, the, you know, if you're on one of those teams, personnel team, you want to make sure and be here at 5 o'clock for your meeting. So that's the upcoming announcements. Pastor Clint has one more thing before we're dismissed.
God died to save us from our sins. He got put in a tomb. He rose 3 days later to save us from our sins.
And Richard, have you put your faith in Jesus for that? Yeah. Well, because of his statement of faith and that he's been baptized in a Sister Baptist church, would you join me in welcoming him to our church family? All right, so I'm going to pray for us, and then come on up here and come shake Richard's hand, tell him that you're glad that he's a part of us. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for time in your house. Time with your people is time in your house, and it's always good. Thank you for that. Thank you for Richard, and I pray, God, that you would help him to know you better. You would help him to grow more in Christ's likeness, and then you would help him to be a blessing to the world. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You're just...